methodology, we got to be able to detect the scenarios and the sensitivity, and then we have to use a important methodological aspect, which is, do we have the data from the supervisor, do we have the models from the supervisor, or can we use our own? And the factors in computing difficulty. So one of the very interesting things that we have observed is, in selecting our methodology, it's important to also look at the trade that takes place between the nations. So how the trading between different trading partners, different trading corridors can impact economy, and how the data from those trading nations can be brought in into your methodology, because that impacts results. Those are the leading indicators that can be included within your methodology. The third important aspect is to identify major exposures. So our portfolio, does it have high foreign exchange exposure, whether we are exposed to interest rate, do we have liquidity risk, do we have credit risk, is there an interbank risk that we are subjected to, and also the equity prices and the real estate prices. So we got to know our own exposure, and that's extremely important in the stress testing. Here again, it's important to highlight that the on and off balance sheet items and the bank's exposure to that needs to be determined. When we look at the exposure, a bank's largest exposure, so the bank always has two books, the capital book, which is the trading desk, and then the banking book, which has the largest risk is the credit risk. So a bank ought to be deterministically able to determine to compute its credit risk and its exposure. The credit risk is, of course, to macro variables such as interest rate, definitely the borrowers, the concentration of borrowers, and the like. So this is very, very important exposure for a financial institution to determine. The next exposure a bank has to look at, the liquidity, and then that exposure will determine the liquidity stress test that we perform. And also, for the liquidity's sake, it's important to conduct sensitivity tests. In what if a certain depositor base was to disappear? How concentrated is a segment of depositors? What happens to that concentration risk, their behavior to be similar? So a bank's exposure to liquidity is important to determine. And then going back again, as stated before, the concentration sensitivity analysis on concentration of risk has to be done. It could be, there are two different cases to it. One is simply for concentration exposure determination, you can do sensitivity analysis. But there could be also complex cases where you would run the regression to determine probability of default on corporate data. So you would create certain dummy variables such as different so you would need to create a model in which the relationship of credit extended to a set of corporate clients, and that against certain macroeconomic variables. That regression needs to be determined to tell how concentrated is your exposure. Similarly, banks ought to identify their exposure to equity, the foreign exchange, and real estate. So the equity prices and FX, they have a similar way to react to exposure, and banks have to determine their net open positions in equities. Also, as stated before, need to see their exposure to off balance sheet items. For real estate prices, there is direct investments that the banks might have made in real estate. There could also be the credit exposure, and also the banks hold real estate as a collateral. So what is their exposure to these collaterals for the sake of stress testing? And finally, it's important for the financial institutions to determine their exposure to the interest rate. Interest rate is very important for the macro policy, the monetary policy. Interest rates can be changed depending on the economic situation, but the banks, their reaction, their sensitivity to changes in interest rate is heightened because, again, it impacts all aspects of their business. In cases of the interest rate, it's also the Basel Committee has given certain guidelines how to look at the interest rate exposure. The next important part is to determine the coverage. Here, it's important to determine the each individual institution's own risk. So if I can, as a bank, determine what is my stress scenario, then I can share the data with the supervisor, and the supervisor can determine the risk, how that is spread to all over to other institutions. It's also important to determine if how consolidated are my reporting. What if I am a subsidiary of a large bank in a country, and am I causing certain risks to the financial system in that area, and what my coverage ought to be. Normally, within a country, the norm is to do the stress testing at the central level, not at the subsidiary level. However, if a foreign bank subsidiary plays an important part within a country, then it ought to be stress tested within that country itself. The next important part is to determine the data and the data sources. There could be financial institution specific data, there could be scenarios related data, what different market risks are available or the bank is exposed to, and then also the data related to the methodology. If there's any supervisory models that ought to be determined, are there any macro scenarios, is there any regulatory input that needs to be considered. So the identification of data sources is an arduous task and has to be started quite early within the process. Next, we go into the implementation. So once we have determined the shock parameters, we have considered the our methodology, we have considered our coverage and exposure, we have determined the data sources, then it's actually to conduct the scenarios. How does different parameters of a bank, how do they look when subjected to extreme scenarios? So for example, it could be how the banks, how could be the extreme GDP scenarios as it moves forward. You create a time series and you would do forecast. Similarly, unemployment. What if you would have the property price drop? What if the houses drop? Once that bank is a specific scenario is computed, what if scenarios are done? Sensitivity analysis, etc., is done. Here the example is, what if the emerging markets, their economic behavior further stresses output of a country, a region, a financial system, and that has impact on GDP changes in the entire world. This is an important part. If you were to look at the macro scenarios for foreign exchange, equity prices, and interest rate, they are very, it's very easy to determine how these macro variables lead to the bank's either the balance sheet impact or the profit and loss impact. However, what if we have other data such as the GDP and unemployment and others. It is very difficult to draw the GDP data into the profit and loss statement of the bank. Hence, there are guidelines that are created, such as these are the terms determined that help. You can use mathematical models to determine what's the probability of default given that the GDP drops by X percentage. What is the loan given, the loss given default caused by a sharp drop in GDP? What is the exposure at default? So what it does is these three terms, there's mathematical models to traverse from the macro variables such as GDP and unemployment and others into probability of default that can be further then talked about how does that impact a bank's position. So within that method, it's important to determine. So I'll walk you through what the previous slide actually meant. First, we'll model impact of a macro on a probability of default model inputs, whether it's the shock levels or it's the correlation. So that method will give us an output, and we ought to be able to determine and assess what's that change. Does that change the ratings? Does that increase or decrease the probability of default? Once that is completed, we have to compare within the historical data of the bank and then report and interpret that data. Can you sum the losses at certain loan levels? Can you have the historical aggregate and charge-offs in such a scenario? So again, the purpose here is there are certain macro variables. We have created those scenarios. We have subjected those scenarios into we've taken the extreme positions. How do they relate to the probability of default? And if there certain default takes place, we were to draw it out from a time series perspective, and what does that mean for the capital adequacy for a financial institution. So once the results are obtained, it's important as a next step to validate the stress test. So the validation is done both qualitatively and quantitatively. It's qualitatively, I believe it's important to know, as Anju talked about, the three levels of defense. At the first level, the front line ought to know whether our tests are valid or not. Are there certain, is there any concentration exposure? Are there certain borrowers' data that's available that ought to be put into the system? And what is the quality of assets that we hold? What is the quality of collateral that's been provided? So the front line can help in determining and validating the stress test output. Further, there could be conceptual boundaries that are placed on a qualitative limit. You cannot say that what if there is the prices drop and it's deflation, prices drop by 20%, etc. So there is, while you have to create an extreme, but there's also a boundary limit that has to be set. The next important validation is the test's replicability. So if I have conducted a stress test in certain scenario, can I replicate that? If I cannot replicate that test, that means it has certain errors. It does not give me confidence to call for capital adequacy, to call for certain changes in my answers. And finally, how well documented is my stress test? Quantitatively, it's very important to check and recheck the models that we have in stress testing. We ought to be able to use the predictive analytics and then compare the forecast with the back testing. So if we have compared certain scenarios, we have created a model, we have our own internal data to check what if such a model would have happened. So if we have created a future scenario, we take that data and apply it in the historical data to allow us to determine if our model is right. Finally, we ought to be able to benchmark our results, and the last process is, do we create enough feedback loop into the system? Because stress testing is not an event, it's a process. It ought to be done time and again. So are we giving enough feedback loop to improve it with better data and repeat of the stress test? Finally, within this, benchmarking is an important aspect of the output. We ought to be able to determine, benchmark our capital adequacy pre-test and post-test. And it has to be given in terms of the probability of default. We have to conduct stress tests in certain time periods. There has to be something to do with the profit treatment. It has to be done with the tax treatment. And finally, the output has to benchmark with the internal strategies of the bank. Quick recap of the model. We identify the shock parameters. We identify the major exposures. We define coverage. We define the data requirement. We implement, we connect to connect macro variables to micro, and then finally get the results. So this is the stress test next. They're frequently asked questions about stress tests, which is, what's the frequency? And it depends. The standard tests are conducted quarterly. There are certain market risk and sensitivity analysis that are monthly. And if there's a elaborate contagion analysis that has to be done by the supervisors, it typically is done annually. Who's the owner? We believe that there has to be a cross-functional teams that include the modelers, statisticians. It requires the frontline managers who understand the exposures the bank has, and the right owners, the chief risk officer at the financial institution. The software tools can be done with simple spreadsheets, or it could be eViews, the statistical modeling tool. There's several vendors such as Risk Metrics that have tools that help determine the stress test. And finally, sharing of the results. So the stress test themselves does trigger the disclosure norms, because most banks are public institutions, and if stress tests have a certain finding, that has to be disclosed both to the supervisors and also to the shareholders. So that's quite a responsibility that need to be undertaken. Finally, I'm going quick here because the next aspect is very good to talk about, that's the corrective measure. So after certain parameters are shocked, we quantify the result, we interpret it and benchmark. There are two aspects. Either a financial institution is resilient, it can withstand and absorb the losses that are to be expected, or it needs to raise its tier one capital, which is an additional buffer that the financial institution need to add to its system. Stress tests can be improved dramatically. EBA, the European Banking Authority, have done certain tests. If prior to the stress test, there's an asset quality review that's performed, which is the assets, they're adjusted, the risk weights are assigned to the assets themselves. They're qualified qualitatively and quantitatively. Their consistency checks in those assets. The importance of AQR actually has shown to dramatically improve the stress testing results. Now, after the stress test is conducted, it leads to a conclusion. And the conclusion is it comes from the Basel III norm, which is there is substantial strengthening of the capital requirements and the capital adequacy for risk-taking institutions. Basel III norms specify that the core tier 1 capital percentage as of a percentage of risk-weighted assets has to be greater than or equal to 8% in the baseline scenario. And in the stressed scenario, it has to be greater than 5.5%. So this is the Basel III guideline. The important aspect of stress testing is to avoid a systemic risk, because a single financial institution can be managed, its capital inadequacy can be managed, but what if it leads to the systemic risk? So the Financial Stability Institute of Bank of International Settlement actually states a very important statement that systemic risk is of far more importance and requires cross-sectional testing for the relevant part of the economy. I have been given a sign that the time is ending, so I'll just go through this quickly. So the last aspect is the statement related to the total regulatory capital. So Basel III has given guidelines on various capitalization guidelines. The first one is the tier 1 capital ratio has to be a minimum of 4.5%. In addition, there's a capital conservation buffer of additional 2.5%, and there is a timeline with which that needs to be built up. There's additional counter-cyclical buffer. This is in times of very fast and very high credit creation, because it has impacts on the economy. And finally, for the systemic important banks, or for the banks that are too big to fail, this additional capital requirement that has been suggested. So there's different timelines of this implementation. And so from here, we can, there's a lot more material. This material will be made available to you. I'd like to sum it up by stating that stress tests by scenarios, by quantitative methods, you can actually determine what is the ability for a system to absorb losses. How resilient is my financial institution? How resilient is a system itself in managing the so-called bad times? And there are guidelines how to build up capital, and there's a timeline also how that capital build-up process is done. And the likes of EBA have even prescribed, in case stress tests are failed, how much is the time? So 2 weeks to give a strategy how to correct, 6 months to put together the right baseline adequate capital, and 9 months to talk about the stress scenario capital adequacy. So those are the final things. Now that this material is available to you, I believe there's a 20-minute break, and Tony will introduce you to that break.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, everyone. Let's give MJ a good big hand for the first half of this.
Sure.
Well done. Thanks so much for that. We'll take a 30-minute break now. Is that right? A 30-minute break. So please grab a coffee, take your time, and we will see you at 10 past. Okay? Thank you very much.